I apologize for showing my face again so quickly. This has been an extraordinary year. We've lost both Emmett Leith and Yuri Denisyuk, and 3 years before that, of course, Stephen Benton. Yuri Denisyuk was born the same year, 1927, in Sochi, Russia, on the Black Sea. He grew up in Leningrad during the Second World War, and he had wanted to do pure research as a boy, but after the war, he completed a degree in physical engineering at the Leningrad Institute of Fine Mechanics and Optics. He then went to work immediately at the Vavilov State Optical Institute. And the Vavilov was the center of the Soviet Union research in optics. It ranged from pure theoretical research to applied development projects for the military. Now, this photo that he sent me from the age of 39 was when he had just begun to receive recognition for his work in holography. It came, he said, from a special notice board where good workers were exposed. Denisyuk's superior was a man named Alexander Elkin, who didn't hold a scientific degree, but he was an important person for his career. Under Elkin, Denisyuk worked on fairly mundane optical design work for the Soviet Navy, but Elkin made it possible for him to pursue a higher degree. Denisyuk began research for a candidate degree in 1958. His original aim was to investigate general imaging and to devise a new kind of display device that could more faithfully reproduce all the properties of an image. He started looking at the work of Gabriel Lippmann, the turn-of-the-century French Nobel Prize physicist. Denisyuk gradually became particularly interested in ways that generalized Lippmann's interference technique that had been used for color photography. Now, Lippmann had also worked in 3D imaging, and that, too, impressed Denisyuk at this early stage. This work was very important for his early conceptions because it suggested an optical geometry that he stuck with for the next few years. But despite working in perhaps the largest optical research center in the world, Denisyuk was rather isolated for this research. His nominated thesis advisor, Eugeni Iudin, had died before he began his work, so he hadn't even had the benefit of advice about what project to choose. His work supervisor, Elkin, didn't have a scientific degree. He wasn't really a supervisor. So in effect, he did his advanced degree without a supervisor, without any direct supervision at all. His only assistant, his only daily contact, was with a woman named Vera Rongonin, who was untrained. She washed the glassware. She didn't really assist beyond that. He used the small but adequate resources of the institute and didn't demand anything further. By 1959, Denisyuk had a clearer idea of what he hoped to do, but he soon encountered difficulties. His conception was of imaging with coherent light, and his light source, a mercury lamp, was very dim. And Lippmann emulsions were far too insensitive to record using it. Now, fortunately, the Vavilov Institute had skilled researchers in emulsions, emulsion chemistry, and with Rebecca Protas, he was able to obtain much more sensitive, high-resolution photographic emulsions. And these were the key to obtaining results. By 1960, he was able to obtain quite good experimental results. And his setup was a generalized Lippmann system. Now, if you know Lippmann photography, you know there are some key elements. Rather than sunlight, he used a monochromatic lamp. Rather than using light focused onto the emulsion to form an image, he used collimated light. And instead of a flat mercury mirror, he used reflective objects such as convex mirrors or a metal ruler. The result was what he called a wave photograph, and he described it as a kind of physical reproduction of the optical form of reflective objects. So you imagine the object itself, in effect embedded within the emulsion, an optical embedding. So a very particular concept, very unlike what Leith did, very unlike what Gabor did. What was the result? Not much. No one paid attention. Denisyuk's lack of a support network meant that his work was largely ignored. His chosen supervisor had died before selecting a problem for him, and he found it difficult to get his first paper published, partly because one academician at the Institute had demanded letters of support from others. Finally, another academician, Vladimir Linick, supported publication, which in fact was necessary to get his degree. The reception in the West was, if anything, worse. he was completely unknown in the West. As I mentioned earlier, Leith and Upatniks had publicized their work as lensless photography. Scientists at the same time saw parallels with what Denisyuk had done only very vaguely. Very few people made the connection. Denisyuk's creations looked and behaved very unlike Leith's holograms. It wasn't until 3 years later, late 1965, that three or four separate American groups almost simultaneously rediscovered what Denisyuk had done. So by experimental results, they found that they could obtain similar results to what Denisyuk had achieved. But Denisyuk got very little credit until the 1970s. So the standard term in the West was not Denisyuk holography, but Lippmann, Lippmann-Prag, reflection or volume holograms. Denisyuk himself apparently didn't see much potential for this technique. He imagined that it must be limited to very shallow objects, and he didn't really conceive that very deep reconstruction was possible even once the laser was available. So all of this early research was without a laser. He took up a post in 1962 as director of a lab at the Vavilov, and he assumed a role very similar to Emmett Leith's in Michigan, leading a group of researchers doing imaging research, principally on imaging radars that didn't involve holography. And the group didn't get lasers until 1965. Denisyuk's status rose only gradually. He was rehabilitated by the explosion of holography in the West. So once Leith and Upatniks became famous, gradually his fame grew as well. In 1969, finally, his status was recognized in the Soviet Union, partly because of two influential people. Peter Kapitsa, a famous physicist who had worked in the West, was able to support him publicly and below the counter, and other workers as well, particularly Mitsislav Keldysh, was able to support him from 1969. So by the 1970s, he was becoming famous. He wrote to me, "My struggles with conservative colleagues and my subsequent triumph had a bad influence on my investigations in the field of holography. During these long years, I was bombarded by journalists and numerous beginners who wished to become involved with holography. These were not my best years." But awards followed. As for Leith, Denisyuk found that his nation recognized his excellence, and he won a succession of awards from the 1970s onwards. He was able to travel more. He traveled to non-Soviet countries as early as 1970, but he became known as a figure in the West, in English-speaking Western world, only in the 1980s. He continued to have a very fertile research career like Leith and came up with a series of very progressive, novel ideas in modern optics. Now, both Leith and Denisyuk are interesting personalities because they became mythological figures, very mythologized. Denisyuk obtained a status as a kind of founding father of the field, and he became a mythical character in the West partly because he was so rarely seen. No one in the West really saw much of Denisyuk until the late 1980s. He visited the UK in 1987 to receive a prize. He went to America the first time in 1989, and this was a quarter century after he had done his seminal research. So for that quarter century, he was known almost by reputation rather than as a living, breathing human being. That reputation was further buttressed by his dedication to the subject through his working life, regular conference contributions from the 1980s, and of course, continuing productivity. Let me end with just one final point. It's often been remarked that Emmett Leith and Yuri Denisyuk shared many similarities. For example, they had rather similar demeanors, self-effacing, generous, dry sense of humor, and their careers and reputations evolved in surprisingly similar ways. Both worked on radar imaging. Both developed variants of holography. Both passed from classified obscurity to relative fame. But it's an even more curious coincidence that their career parallels even extended to their lifespans. The two survived to within a week of the same age, 78 years, 10 months, and 18 and 11 days, respectively. Thanks.